All right, can you hear me? Thanks for the kind introduction and thanks for the invitation. It's my great pleasure to have this opportunity to share our research result. This is Chan Byung-che from the Yonsei University in Korea. So in my talk, I'd like to introduce the 60 MIMO, more specifically from an electromagnetic theory perspective. So I will talk about why electromagnetic theory becomes more important for 6G, and I will introduce a specific topic for this, just one example, namely the lens MIMO. So I'm given only 20 minutes, so I might not be able to explain everything that I prepared, and please send me an email after my talk, and I will share my material. So what is 6G? I believe you have heard about this question so many times during this event. So 6G networks, they will be able to use higher frequencies than 5G networks and provide substantially higher capacity and much lower latency. So one of the goals of the 6G internet is to support the 1 microsecond latency communications. That is 1,000 times faster than the 1 millisecond and the latency so far we have. So these are the potential use cases for the 6G. I got this information from the Ericsson's white paper. Among all the keywords here, I'd like focused on the 60 MIMO. And as I mentioned earlier, the 60 network will support the 1 microsecond latency communications. And also, the 6G will achieve the 1 terabit per second peak data rate and 1 gigabit per second user experiences the data rate. So naturally, we should achieve the double spectral efficiency compared to 5G networks. And these numbers are quite challenging, and we definitely need the more the spatial and spectral resources. So what are the advantages of 6G versus 5G? So here we have some comparison numbers, and we could skip now. So the thing is that here, again, to achieve the target goals, and we need more spectrum and more the spatial resources. So there's no doubt that the millimeter wave plays a key role in 5G. However, due to its severe path loss issues, and we need multiple antennas to achieve higher directivity gain. Suppose here that we need 64 antenna elements. For under 6 gigahertz spectrum, say 3.5 gigahertz, the array size should be approximately 176 by 176, which is too big. On the other hand, on millimeter wave spectrum, it's only 8 by 8 at 77 gigahertz and 22 by 22 at 28 gigahertz spectrum. It's like just the palm size. So it's feasible. To further minimize the array size, we could use something special approach. So in this talk, as an example to achieve the target numbers, I mean several KPIs, I'd like to introduce the electromagnetic-based antenna technology. So far, we only considered the plane, the wavefront, assuming the distance between the transmitter and the receiver is quite far. So I believe that, I mean, the other speakers introduced more like a pure kind of the contents on the communication, the spectrum, and the technologies. But in my talk, not to overlap with the other talks, I will introduce a very specific idea coming from an electromagnetic theory. So like what we have moved from sub-6 gigahertz spectrum to the millimeter wave spectrum for 5G. So we may now have the immigration, the much higher the spectrum. The IEEE ITU defines the terahertz as 0.3 terahertz to 3 terahertz, but the academic community uses 0.1 terahertz to 10 terahertz. from the perspective of the devices and the subsystem capabilities. So we will focus on the range from 100 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz. So unlike the below 28 gigahertz spectrum at terahertz the frequencies, the channel response is dominated by the molecular absorption losses. So from the figure, which may not be quite clear in this slide here, but 130 gigahertz to the 140 gigahertz band is the kind of the promising. So of course, the lower and the wider spectrum, the better and the for the 6G. So then what is the problem? Can you just use the sub-terahertz spectrum? The higher the spectrum, the severe the path loss. Eventually, the shorter the communication distance. So this is a problem we should care about. So until 5G era, we never worried about the wavefront. So we always assume the plain wave for the system design and performance analysis. So due to the time constraint, it's hard to explain all the things about this, but there is a kind of the decision boundary to determine between the spherical waveform model and planar wavefront model. So it is called Fraunhofer distance, and it's given by, here this equation, d is greater than 4 small d squared of the lambda. So here, the capital D is the distance, and the small d means the aperture size. So we might have a question that how we have this formula. So here is the answer. I will skip this slide, but you can take a look at after my presentation to get the point. And we set pi over 8 as the some negligible phase differences. And then we finally got that Fraunhofer the distance. So, and then what is the point again? As the carry frequency increases, we should also consider the spherical, the wavefronts depending on the system and parameters. So therefore, for the scenarios where we should consider spherical the wavefront model and far field beamforming as not valid anymore. So because of the nonlinear phase differences and far field beamforming as pressed energy, and it could not resolve the severe path loss issues. As you could see from the figures in the second row here, and poorly focused beam based on planar wave mode can cause the here, we have the severe the power and gain loss. And by the way, I got these figures from Professor Ling Long Dai's paper, and you can have the more information from his paper he uploaded on the archive. So as you can see here, near field propagation is able to improve the accessibility. Now here, we have the new terminology, distance domain SDMA, like what we had the angle domain SDMA in 4G and 5G. So let me ask a question, a simple question here. Do you have any idea how we focus the beam energy? Do you remember the toys or some scientific tools you used to play with in your childhood? Yes, that's the magnifying glass. Depending on the curvature and also the characteristics of lens, the focal point is determined. So if we focus well, we could even, you know, burn the paper, right? So we now wonder if we could use this kind of lens for the communications. So the answer is, of course, yes. Like what we used the magnifying glass to see bigger. So we could also use a lens to concentrate the radiated energy into a narrow beam or to focus the received energy on the receiving dipole or horn. So in conventional systems, the focusing energy is achieved by the phase array. So the question is that, what are pros and cons of the lens antenna, lens array? So before giving an answer to this question, let me first explain some basics of the lens. So many people in this talk may not be quite familiar with electromagnetic lens characteristics. And what should we know to understand the lens? That is a question. So we need to first understand the power distribution. Suppose there is no lens, then each antenna element receives the same signal power. However, thanks to the lens here, we have a focused energy at some point. And for system analysis, we could approximate the power profile with the Gaussian shape or sinc and zinc functions. And of course, we could use the numerical techniques called beam propagation methods. So I believe you can download the software from our GitHub link. We already shared all the source codes for analyzing the lens characteristics using the beam propagation method. So using this tool that we developed it, that we could measure the electric field and magnetic field, the distribution. If we cut at 30 lambda of the propagation distance, you know, it looks like a sinc function. And then who proposed the lens antenna? So history of the lens antennas for the millimeter wave systems is not really long. The lens antennas has been studied by the several groups. In 2011, people from University of the Wisconsin proposed the planar microwave lens using layered materials to achieve the different reflective indices. And you know, in 2014, Ray Zhang's group from the NUS they investigated the electromagnetic lens-based systems from a communication perspective. And you know, in 2015, Nokia used 73 gigahertz lens antennas for their very first millimeter wave systems. These are some of the measurement results. The thing is that here, when feed number one is active, we have the tilted the radiation pattern. Like we could expect, we have the high power at some point. I mean, the based on the location of the feeding point, and also the we have the, I don't have the laser pointer, but we have the center some shape when the feed number center is active. So they have confirmed that the proposed lens and the antenna, it could cover plus minus 17.5 degrees in azimuth and plus minus 4 degrees in elevation. But unfortunately, this beam steering range was not that wide to fulfill the system requirement for the 5G. And the Professor Said group from, again, the Wisconsin, and they released their lens MIMO systems at GlobeCom in 2016. And they used their own TXRX platforms, but they haven't shared all the details yet. And of course, we also proposed the solutions. So in 2015, we first fabricated the lens at 77 gigahertz. As you could see here, the size is extremely small. As an example, for 64 by 64 configuration, the total patch size is about approximately 8 centimeter by 8 centimeter. So we fabricated the three different lenses using two different materials, polyethylene and Teflon. We also designed a new lens at 28 gigahertz and also even at 140 gigahertz for the 6G communications. So of course, we measure the RF performances first in an anechoic chamber, then got quite remarkable the results. It achieved about 28 dBi directional gain, as an example, at 77 gigahertz carrier frequency. So considering the typical patch size achieves only 5 dBi, the gain by the length is not that marginal. I would say it's quite significant. And also we could confirm the accuracy of the beam propagation method too with design. And we could confirm from the figure on the right side. So for the more reliable and realistic performance analysis, we have also carried out 3D ray tracing based simulations and also prototyping using NIST, the SDR platform. And we were able to conclude this approach is worth to further investigate for the 6G. So here I prepare a short video clip to introduce the 6G MIMO, I mean the 6G lens MIMO. Let's watch. So here, instead of having the phase array, we directly use the electromagnetic lens to focus the beam to a certain direction that we wanted and we desired. So that is one example, 28 gigahertz the system. And then we also implemented 5G and all the baseband with the NI. And also we used our system, also sometimes with Anokyu Wave the chipset or other the millimeter wave phased array the configurations. And we demonstrated our system at the several conferences. And this is the one from the IEEE GlobeCom we did a while ago. And we achieved the more than 2 gigahertz the spectrum with our design, the EM, the lens antennas. With 800 megahertz bandwidth and which is the 64 constellation. That is lens to phase array antenna configuration. And also we have the lens to lens and other configuration as well. So we're doing some more improvements for the 6G sub terahertz spectrum. That is the one picture to reduce the beam switching, the latency as well. And of course, we've done the system level the evaluations to see the real impact of the proposed system. Just for simplicity, we assume the 5 users for the multi-user MIMO systems, and also we implemented several low-complexity beam sweeping algorithms as well. Of course, including S3, the music classical one, and also PROOF, which is the designed by our research group, and we confirmed we achieved much higher throughputs than the conventional systems. Okay, so based on our preliminary results, so we will demonstrate the transparent reflective surface for the beam focusing. Once we know the location of the UEs, of course we could do better. So we will share the more details later after the demonstration at CES early next year at Las Vegas. I think it's the already timed out, but I think we could get some question if you have. Thank you so much.
Thank you.